Hello, I'm Mr. Arne Junior, retired lecturer in metallurgy, preaching Christianity and Sikhism. Here I've got a very lengthy passage from DGO, and I will split it into different parts about Jesus' last days or crucifixion. And it is a St. Mark 14, verse 1 to 72, and 15, verse 1 to 47. So I will split it into parts. Holy Gospel of our Supernatural Father, Elohim, Allah, Far From, etc., delivered by the first anointed Christ, which in Punjabi we call Satguru, Jesus, according to St. Mark 14, 1 to 72, 15, 1 to 47. The Passover and the Feast of the Unleavened Bread were to take place in 2 days' time. Now this unleavened bread, you know, they even use it on Sabbath. They use a leavened bread for the 6 days, and on Sabbath they use unleavened bread, meaning that on Sabbath you do the work for God, which is Elohim, Supernatural Father, and His bread of life, which is His Word. It comes through revelations, direct. And nobody can leaven the bread. Nobody can tamper with it. So this leavened bread also means that our past sins gone, we start the life afresh after the Passover. So it was a good encouragement to the people. So the chief priests and the scribes were seeking a way to arrest him by treachery and put him to death. They said, not during the festival, for fear that there may be a riot among the people, because there will be many people would come from different countries and they would not like it, you know. When he was in Bethany, reclining at table in the house of Simon the leper, a woman came with an alabaster jar of perfumed oil, costly, genuine, spikened. She broke the alabaster jar and poured it on his head. There were some who were ignorant. No, there were some who were indignant. Why has there been this waste of perfumed oil? It was Judas Iscariot, you know, who was the greedy one. He was holding the purse, and whenever he wants some money, he will steal it from the purse for his own purpose. In Jesus, we give to the church. We don't take money out of the church, as opposite to the synagogue. In the synagogue, the priest takes the money from the people. He doesn't give. He is the ruler. So it was Judas Iscariot, the thief. It could have been sold for more than 300 days' wages, and the money given to the poor. That's how the thief will pretend, you know, that they are very honest, you know, and they are good, as you can see in so many charities, you know, this thing happening. They were infuriated with her. He was infuriated with her. Jesus said, let her alone. Why do you make trouble for her? She has done a good thing for me. The poor you will always have with you, and whenever you wish, you can do good to them, but you will not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anticipated anointing my body for burial. Amen. I say to you, wherever the gospel is proclaimed to the whole world, what she has done will be told in memory of her. Then Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went off to the chief priests to hand him over to them. I think he went after, you know, when there was a, he was thrown out at the Last Supper, before Jesus washed the feet of the 11. There is some twisting in these gospel, you know. Then Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went off to the chief priests to hand him over to them. When they heard him, they were pleased and promised to pay him money. Remember that at the last days, they were all friends. Friends mean they can represent each other, and they are ready to die for each other. And they were so perfect, all of them, that if a stranger come to find out who is the real Christ among them, he would not have found it, because they were friends. Lazarus was also one of his friends. So that's why the temple priest could not recognize the real Christ. He was in the temple all the time, but still, you know, they find it difficult to recognize the real Christ, because everybody was speaking the same language and had the powers. So that's why they gave the insider, Judas Iscariot, 30 shekels to catch Jesus. Then Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went off to the chief priests to hand over to them. When they heard him, they were pleased. They were pleased that somebody can recognize him, and promised to pay him money. Then he looked for an opportunity to hand him over. On the first day of the feast, unleavened bread, when they sacrificed the Passover lamb, his friends, and not the once-born disciples, said to him, "Where do you want us to go and prepare for you to eat the Passover?" So he sent two of his friends and said to them, "Go into the city, and a man will meet you, carrying a jar of water." Now this is important, jar of water. Remember, Jesus said, "Unless you are born of water and of spirit, you have no part in me." Carrying a jar of water means he was a man of conscience, a salt of the earth. Remember John the Baptist? He baptized Jewish men in water in the name of Abraham, making them salt of the Abraham. So this water means that he, the person, will be salt of Abraham, faithful. Follow him. Wherever he enters, say to the master of the house, this is the house, and I am the master. The teacher says, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my friends? Now this is, you know, a metaphor also, it has been used. The guest house for the Jesus is my heart. Alright? So, we invite Jesus into our heart to have the Passover. So he can, the sins are out and spirituality come in. Luke 16 verse 16. John the Baptist was the last prophet, and after that there was no prophet. Jesus was the very Son of God. And then the people need to be solitary in order to enter the royal kingdom of God, which has a narrow gate. And here it is, this royal kingdom of God. John the Baptist baptized, royal kingdom of God. You have to enter through this narrow gate where the true vine, Christ Jesus, is planted. So this one, you can find it in my description, or I can send you one. This is a Christianity in a nutshell. Where is my guest room where I may eat? Remember, in some of the Gospels it said that guest room was never used by anyone before. It was just new one, this heart. When you are solitary, then you are master of your own destiny. And this heart, nobody will use it except Christ inside you. Christ can only come here when you are master of your own destiny. John 9, the born blind person, is a typical example of the master of his own destiny. So such people we need to fish solitary, not the stooges of the temple high priest or so and so. Then he will show you a large upper room, furnished and ready. Make the preparations for us there. The friends then went off, entered the city, and found it just as he had told them, and they prepared the Passover. When it was evening, he came with the 12, and as they reclined at table and were eating, Jesus said, Amen, I say to you, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me. That means Judas Iscariot, he shows more that he is very close to him, but he is not. Heart is different. You cannot read the heart of a person. So it is better to be solitary and be master of your own destiny. Everyone has to give his own account to God. Nobody can give your account. They began to be distressed and to say to him one by one, surely it is not I. He said to them, one of the 12, the one who dips with me into the dish. For the Son of Man indeed goes as it is written of him, but woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. That means it would be better for that man if he had never been born. That is, Jesus gave a verbal rebuke. Jesus gave a verbal rebuke. That is, a verbal rebuke by Jesus was enough for Judas Iscariot. You know, when they killed Jesus and it became blood money, He could not take the blood money to his house. So then Judas Iscariot to kill himself. But in India we had kings and emperors of darkness that needed sword power to sort them up. So this is a Sikhism is continuation of Christianity, and Nanak was the second coming of Jesus. And we had a very high level of sons of Satan. So they needed sword power to sort them up. While they were eating, he took bread. Now I will leave it here, and because this baptism, which is Eucharist, baptism of Jesus in Holy Spirit, which is Eucharist, is also called entering into the bridal chamber. This he did it after eating and all that, and then Jesus took them to wash their feet, and after washing their feet, then he performed this Eucharist ceremony. That is, after he had entertained the 11, you know, into the house of our Father, and then here, you know, at the Last Supper, Jesus threw Judas Iscariot out for being a thief. And remember, these docholo priests in your churches, they are also stealing money from the church purse as their salaries. They are not working for God, they are working for Mammon money, and they are hypocrite. So you need to be having in Jesus fellowship of the royal priest. Royal priests don't need anything, anybody. Wherever two or three royal priests are sitting together, Jesus is among us sitting. Because you have to think logically. So here I will leave it, and I will carry on with the rest later in the next one.